Welcome everyone to this talk about Akka Streams in practice. I hope this talk will be a bit refreshing at this conference because it has really not much to do with functional programming, apart from the fact that the code samples will be in Scala, which can be a functional programming language. So my name is Jacek Kunicki. I work at Software Mill. We are a remote software house based in Poland. So this talk is going to be about stream processing. And stream processing, I think that most of you are aware of the concept or can at least imagine what it is about. So we have some kind of source of data that we want to process. We can call it a producer. At the end, we have a consumer or a place where the data flows after being processed. And then we have a number of processing stages. And of course, we have the data flowing from the producer to the through the processing stages to the consumer. Now, this is like a basic idea of stream processing. But Akka Streams, which we will be talking about, is about reactive stream processing. And reactive streams, if you haven't heard of it yet, is basically a standard for asynchronous stream processing with non-blocking back pressure. So I will explain this back pressure thing in a second. So in this scenario, where you have like a producer and a consumer, you can imagine basically two situations. You can imagine having a slow producer and a fast consumer. And then basically you have no problem because the producer is producing the data in a slow manner. When the consumer is fast, it's able to produce the data as soon as the producer has generated it. But you can also imagine an opposite situation where the producer is fast and the consumer is slow. And then, well, there is a danger that the consumer will be flooded with data. And basically, back pressure is a mechanism to deal with it. So in a reactive stream, in the reactive stream standards, we have the data flowing in one direction from producer to consumer, basically down the stream. But we have also something called back pressure, which is basically signaling that is the signaling data goes up the stream. So basically, the next stage can signal to the previous stage how much of data does it want. And this is, well, I'm not going to dig into the implementation of it, but you need to be aware of the fact that basically in a reactive stream processing, there is a way for the consumers to signal demand to the producers. And this lets the consumers not be flooded with data. So it is basically a way of slowing down the producer somehow. So this is like the general terminology for stream processing. Akka Streams, which is one of the implementations of the Reactive Stream standard, has its own naming. And in Akka Streams, the producer is called the source, the consumer is called the sink, and the intermediate stages are called flows. And all these things tied together form something that is called a graph. So the stream processing world is quite big. Well, this is just a number of technologies. It's an excerpt from my colleague's talk about a small introduction to big data. You can see that there is like a number of solutions that they serve various purposes. And Akka Streams is somewhere among them. Actually, it's not on the slide, but. So what's special about Akka Streams? First of all, it is, or it used to be, not distributed, like unlike Spark Streaming or technologies like this. I said it used to be not distributed because actually Akka Streams is basically a recipe for stream processing, and the actual implementation may vary. And the basic implementation of Akka Streams is not distributed, but recently, it was October last year, there was another implementation announced using Apache GearPump. Apache GearPump is also a stream processing framework, but a distributed one. And actually, the Apache GearPump people have created an implementation of Akka Streams that can be distributed. So this may no longer hold true that Akka Streams is not distributed. In Akka Streams, we basically have a DSL for defining reusable building blocks. That let's just let us say how do we want to process the data, and we basically provide like isolated building blocks, and then build a graph from them. And this is our recipe for the data processing. And since this is a recipe, and it's quite an important thing here, that the recipe itself is lazy. So if we build a graph definition using Akka Streams DSL, nothing actually happens until we run the graph. So this is just a lazy recipe, and only when we run it, so when we it's called materialization in the Akka Streams world. So basically, we turn the recipe into like something that is actually run. And as I said, Akka Streams has a default implementation for materializing the graphs. And this one, the default one, is based on an actor system. So, well, Akka is, if you heard of Akka, you may have heard of it in terms of actors and an actor systems. And an actor system is actually what is used underneath in the default implementation or default materialization of a graph. So this session is will be a live coding once, and we're going to have a quite simple example and like data we'll be dealing with. So this is going to be a set of CSV or actually semicolon separated files with values separated by semicolons. And what the data looks like is that in every file we have like pairs of lines that have an ID, and each of the line can or cannot have a valid value. There are always two lines with the same ID, and they can either have a valid value, or it can happen that none of them has a valid value. To make things, well, a bit less trivial, the files are gzipped, so they are compressed, and we'll be uncompressing them on the fly. Then when we uncompress the data, we're going to group the lines by the IDs, so we will process in groups of two and averaging the values, of course having some dummy default value when both the values are invalid, so that we are not able to compute the average. And ultimately, we'll be storing the data in Cassandra, which is one of the NoSQL databases to really, well, for this scale of data, it really doesn't matter, but well, I chose Cassandra because it theoretically it allows, for example, for fast inserts. So if you want to process your data in a fast manner, then and in a write-only fashion, then Cassandra may be a good choice here. Okay, so this is for the slides. Now let's jump to the live coding part. If any of you can see the code, I encourage you to come closer. There's a lot of space here. Unfortunately, I cannot make it really bigger because I won't see anything on my screen. Okay, so we have a base for our implementation, a class called CSV importer. It has a number of configuration parameters that we'll be using later. So first of all, when dealing with our files, we will have lines. And we want to split the lines to extract an ID and the value from the lines. So we're going to define a method called parseLine. And well, it would take a file path just for like logging purposes so that we can see what's happening. And it's also going to take the actual line to parse. This is defined as a partially applied function so that we can use in map or flat map afterwards. And this is going to return a future of a reading. And the reading is basically part of our domain model. So the domain model is pretty simple. We have a reading trait, so a reading always has an ID. And then we can have a valid reading, which has a value apart from the ID. Or we can have an invalid reading, which just holds the ID, and it's like a way of marking that one of the more of the readings are invalid. Okay, so this is our future. Well, the first thing we're going to do is to split the line by the colon. And this will be our fields. Now we're going to take the first field, convert it to int. And this is going to be our ID. The second field is going to be converted to a double. And this is going to be our value. Sorry for the caps lock. And now, in the happy path, we are returning a valid reading which has an ID and has a value. Of course, this is only the happy path because, as you may remember, it may happen that there is not a valid value. So we need to deal with it as well. That's why we're going to wrap it in a try-catch statement. And we're basically catching anything that may go wrong. We can log it just for information purposes. And here we're going to return an invalid reading with the ID. And this way, our parse line method will always return something that at least has an ID. It may have a value when it's a valid one, but if it's not, it just has an ID. And there's a typo here, which I'm going to correct. Okay, so the next, I said that our files are zipped. Even if they were not zipped, we wouldn't want to like to read the entire file into memory. We want to like stream the contents of a file and also de-zip it on unzip it on the fly. And to do this, well, so we will basically be streaming bytes from the file. So we need a way to like divide the byte stream into lines. So we're going to somehow detect the new line character. Using this, we're going to separate, like extract lines from the file. So we're going to define first building block of our graph that we'll be using for processing. It's going to be called line delimiter. The type of this line delimiter is going to be a flow. The flow, as you remember from the previous slides, is the Akka Streams name for the processing stage within our graph. And the flow has three type parameters. First is the type of the value that comes in. The second one is the value that comes out of a flow. And the third one, called mat, is the type of something called the materialized value. And basically, the materialized value is something that can be emitted from the flow, from the graph component, to the outside world. Because the in and out types are just like in terms of the data flowing between the graph stages. And the materialized value is something that can go outside. Actually, we won't be using it here, but well, the type is here, so I wanted to explain it. So our line delimiter stage will be working on bytes, or actually over on byte strings, because well, the byte string is like Akka Streams abstraction for strings or characters. So we're going to read byte strings, emit byte strings as well, I said that we won't be using the materialized value, and for telling the compiler that we are not using the materialized value, we have a not used, which is like basically kind of a void or null, but it's from the Akka Streams DSL. So to split the bytes by new line character, we have a helper object which is called framing. It has a delimiter method, and the delimiter method has three parameters. First of all is the string by which we want to divide the stream. So in our case it's the new line character. Then we need to provide the maximum length of the line. In our case, well, the values are rather short because those are like short numeric things separated with a semicolon. So 128 is a like reasonable maximum value. The third parameter that we want to provide is something called allow truncation. And it basically says what to do with a part of the stream which doesn't end with a new line character. So if we specified allow truncation to be false, then there would be an error when it encouraged a line that a part of the stream that doesn't end with a new line character. And actually, we want to be able to not add a new line character to the end of our file, for example. So we'll just set it to true to be able to handle this case. And this is the end of the definition of our first building blocks. So now let's to recap what it does is basically takes a stream a byte stream and divides it into larger strings by the new line character. And that's it. So the next step is going to be file parsing. So file parsing is a flow as well. The input type for the flow is a file, because it would take a file, and from files it would emit a readings. Well, actually, in a single file we can have a number of readings, but our flow would like somehow aggregate the readings and emit and take in a file. It would emit the readings one by one. By the way, all the code is in a GitHub repository, so you don't have to take notes at all. It's basically the same version that's here. And again, we're going to ignore the materialized value because, well, we're not interested in it. And now, to define a flow, we start with the flow object, which has a type. In our case, the entry point for our flow will be a file. So we're starting with a flow of file. And now what we are going to do is from every file, we'll convert every file that arrives into a source of readings. Source in terms of the Akka Streams naming for stream elements. So every file will be converted into a source, and then we somehow want to flatten the source because we don't want to emit a sequence of readings, but we want to emit the readings one by one. So we have a source that can emit readings, and we want to flatten the source so that the readings will be emitted one by one. To do this, we have a helper method that is called flatmapconcat, and it basically takes a source. It takes like an input. Here, the input is a file. And what it will be doing is it will be like converting each file into a source, then flattening the source, and we'll be able to emit the readings one by one. So our files are dezipped, so we need a dezip input stream, which will wrap around a file input stream, and we'll take our file. This is going to be our stream. Now we have a helper that is called stream converters. Sorry. And we can provide an input stream, actually a function that returns an input stream. And now we want to like every reading, but like every not every reading, but like every. We want to pipe the byte through our line delimiter stage, so the one that we defined previously. To say that to express it in the DSL, we have a via method, and we basically say via line delimiter. Sorry. Now we also want to have an option to skip a number of lines from the file because, for example, we can have a header row with the column names. So here we have a configuration parameter for it. And it's called lines to skip. So we said that we want to drop a number of lines. Then what comes out of our line delimiter stage are byte strings, and actually we want like a normal Scala string. So for every value, for every byte string that comes here, we want to extract a normal Scala string. So the method here is called UTF-8 string. And the last thing we want to do, we want to convert, we want to parse the line. So at the very beginning, we defined a method for parsing a line. So now we want to use it, so that from a string, we have our domain object, which is a reading. And actually we'll have a lot of lines coming from a single file. And this is a good place to introduce some parallel processing because we can parse the lines in parallel. We don't need to do it one by one. So to do some parallel processing, we have a map async method that, it takes a parameter that's called parallelism, and it basically says how many threads would be created to do the things in parallel. For this, we also have a configuration parameter. It's called non-IO parallelism, basically used for the non-IO operations. And of course, it also takes the logic, the actual processing logic. It is something that returns the future, and this is why our parse line method returns the future. So it's a perfect fit here, and this is also the reason why we defined it as a partially applied function, so that we can just provide the path to the file here. And the second parameter would be passed by the map method itself. This is a map async is a parallel processing variant which doesn't consider the order of completion of the futures that are launched in the inside. So in our case we really it doesn't matter what the order is. So we can. Sorry, yeah, it does. Yeah, you're right. I noticed that something is wrong with what I'm saying, and actually, yeah, map async unorder does it the other way around. So, and of course, the line order is significant here because we want to have pairs with subsequent IDs that are the same, so that we can group by the IDs. So this is like the slower variant because it preserves the order it waits for the features to complete and just emits downstream in the order that they arrive. There is also a faster variant called map async unordered, which basically emits the result of the future. It emits it downstream as soon as the future is complete. So it is faster, but it ignores the order. Okay, so this is our file parsing stage. Now, after parsing the file,
why do you actually need to keep the order?
Because I have every two subsequent lines, I need to process. Yeah, I need to because we have like two lines with the same ID, and we want to keep it an average. Right. So if we mix the order of the lines, we wouldn't have the same ID. Yeah. Okay. So the next step is actually computing the average. It's once again going to be a flow. And here the input type will be the reading, and output type will be a valid reading, since we want to accept every type of reading. It can either be a valid reading with an ID and a value, or it can be an invalid reading with just an ID. But what we want to emit is actually a valid reading that will hold the ID and hold the average. Of course, as I said, the average can have a dummy value if there are no valid values to process. But we want to emit something that all that has a value so that we can store it to the database afterwards. And once again, we're ignoring the output here. So average computing is a flow that takes a reading. Now we're grouping the readings in a groups of two. So that's the important thing here. We'll be emitting sequences of two, and to the sequence, we will apply the actual average computation. And here we are using the, after we group them in the sequences of two, we no more care about the order. So now having the pairs, we can just process them in an async way and also in an unordered way. So as soon as the result is ready, we can emit it downstream because, well, we no more care about the order of things. We are still going to use the non-IO parallelism. What we're going to get here is a sequence of readings because grouped emits a sequence. It would be a pair, but a pair is still a sequence. Since it's a map async, it requires us to return a future, so we'll be returning one. The first thing we have to do now is take the readings and actually collect the valid ones. From a pair of readings, we need to extract the valid ones. So whenever the reading that arrived is a valid one, we're just returning it. And those are our valid readings. And now it's time to compute the average. So there are two cases. Well, if the valid readings, if there is any valid reading present, so if they are not empty, we take the valid readings, extract the value, we sum the values, and divided by the size of valid readings. Of course, well, it's like a bit too much if there is only a single valid reading, but like for the sake of clarity, I won't be extracting a separate case for when there is a valid reading. So we can like compute average of a single reading in this way as well. And otherwise, if there are no valid readings at all, we return a dummy value of minus one. It doesn't really matter what this one is. It's just a dummy one. And to return a valid reading, for this we need an ID. And since we always have, we have always two elements in our readings, so we are safe to take a head from the collection and extract an ID. And here we have the average. So this is the average computing part. Once again, we're grouping the readings into groups of two, which both readings share the same ID. Then we take all the valid readings and try to compute an average from them. If there is no valid reading, we just return minus one as a result. The last step is going to be storing our readings into a database. And actually the building block stores a valid reading. So this is a recipe how to store a single reading in a database. It's once again going to be a flow that takes a valid reading. And the output type is something called a result set. And this is like, this is something internal to the Cassandra driver that I'm using. So it's not a Java SQL result set. It's something from the DataStax driver. As previously, we'll be ignoring the materialized value here. And this one is pretty simple. So we have a flow of valid reading. Now we can also do it in an unordered manner. But this time, well, storing into a database is an I/O operation, it may be slower, so we may want to have a different parallelism for this kind of operations. So we have a configuration parameter that's called concurrent writes, which basically says how many inserts do we want to do at a time. Of course, we could, if you wanted to further optimize it, we could do batch inserts, for example. But well, this is not the core of this talk, so we'll skip insert optimization here. We'll just leverage as asynchronous inserts with some level of parallelism. So what we have here is a reading. And what we do with the reading is we have some kind of reading repository that has a save method, which takes a reading and stores it into Cassandra and returns a future. So this is a non-blocking one as well. And we want to do some logging afterwards, just to have some information in our logs. So basically, if the write succeeds, we log that it has succeeded. If it fails, we log that it failed and some error information. So now we have defined almost all the building, like the blocks of our stream, our file processing pipeline. So now we're going to like put them together in a bigger flow that will basically be composed of the steps that we defined previously. So we'll call the flow import single file. And its type, well it'd be a flow that takes a file. So that's the very entry point of our pipeline. And the very end of our pipeline is the result set that is returned from the store reading part. So here. So the output type will be the result set. And we'll, for the sake of simplicity, we're going to still ignore what's the materialized value. And here we won't be adding any implementation. We'll just be composing the blocks that we defined previously. So this is a flow of a file. And like we have the files. And we are piping them, first of all, via the parse file stage, which takes a file and transforms it into readings. Then it goes through the compute average step. And finally, it goes to the through the store reading step. And this is a simple definition of what we actually want to do with our files. Just to recall, it's lazy, so nothing happens here so far. We are just like describing the way we want to process our data. We're not doing any processing yet until we actually run it, which we will be doing a bit later. So now we have our flow that we want to use to process our files. So let's define the actual method that will somehow run it. We're going to call it import from files. And first of all, we're using our configuration parameter, the import directory. We're going to list the files that are there, convert it to list. So that we can easily use it in as a Akka Streams source. It's easier to just use a list for a source than a sequence. So that's why I'm converting here. So we're going to store it in a variable files. We can do some logging here that we're basically starting an import. We can do some time measurement here, so using the old good system current time millis for the milliseconds. And now what we want to do with our files is to we want to process a file after file, because, well, there may be a number of those files. Actually, what we want, what we would like to achieve is to have a fixed pool of workers, where each of the workers would be actually running the import single file flow, the one we defined here. And we want to have a source of files that will be emitting those files and load balancing them to this pool of workers. So we have a configuration parameter for the number of files that we want to process in parallel, and basically we want to implement some kind of load balancing. So we're going to have another flow which is going to be a balancer, and the balancer is a flow that takes a file. Actually, we don't really care what it's what is the output value, because, well, it can be it doesn't really matter here. We'll be ignoring it. The materialized value will not be used once again. I leave the implementation empty for a second, just to first of all, I want to show how we build the entire the processing flow. So how do we run the actual flow, and then we'll shortly go back to the implementation of the actual balancer. So now what we do, we create a source which has our files. So it would, as a source, would basically emit the files one by one. And now we want to run it via our balancer. This still doesn't run anything, so but this is still a recipe. In the first place, when we actually tell the Akka streams to do something, to run the flow, is the run with part. And to run our graph, we need to provide a sink, so the ultimate element of our graph, so the consumer in the typical stream processing terminology. And since we don't really care about what data is output, because we already stored it into a database, and what we really care about is that the process that stores into the database has completed, we'll be ignoring it. So for the sake of simplicity, we're running it through sync ignore, which basically waits for the stream to complete, but doesn't do anything with the materialized values. So that's why we could also use the not used object for our materialized value, because we'll ignoring it anyway, so we won't make use of it. And afterwards we can do some logging once again, so that we just know what's happening. Okay, so now let's get back to the load balancing stage and how to define it. So this would be a bit more complicated one than the previous flows, because we'll be using another way to define the building blocks, which is called a graph DSL. So it's another a DSL for non-trivial cases, where we can do, for example, balancing and many other things. So we're going to define a graph using the graph DSL object. We have a create method. We have an implicit builder, which is basically, it will be used to add new elements to the graph. We are going to import the actual DSL. It's called graph DSL implicits underscore. Those are some helper, for example, funny arrows that we are going to define the processing flow with. So what we want to do here is, first of all, have a balancing step that would take the file and just balance them through our pool of workers. We're using the builder to add a new step to our graph. The step is actually called balance. It takes a type. In our case, it's file. And we need to say how many workers we're going to have. Fortunately, we have a configuration parameter for it. It's called concurrent files. And then after we balance, so after we split our stream of files into multiple workers, we want to somehow wait for all the workers to complete and gather the balanced processing results somehow. In Akka streams, it's called merging. So we need to have another step in our graph. It's called merge, and we will do it in pretty much the same way. So we're going to add a merge step, whose type will be a result set. So this is the result set that is returned by the database storing part. And we also need to provide the number of number of inputs that it's going to have. And actually, those values, those number of outputs and inputs, so outputs for the balance step and inputs for the merge step, those are not verified in compile time because, well, it's not possible, but they are verified at runtime. So when Akka Streams is running the graph, so when it's materializing it, it actually look like it checks whether the like numbers of inputs and outputs match. So if we connected something in the wrong way, so for example, if there were too few inputs in the merge state, it would complain because of course, provided that we tried to attach something to a non-existent input, for example. So this is verified during the materialization. So it's really hard to go wrong here. And the other thing that is verified this time on the compile stage, in compile time, is all the things here. So all the via methods, they are type safe. So they are strongly typed as everything in Scala. So it's not possible to, for example, connect a flow that emits, I don't know, files to another flow that accepts strings, because the compiler would complain at the very beginning. So we are pretty much safe here. So now what we want to do is for every number of concurrent files, we want to create this number of connections between the balancing step, our worker, which is import from files, and the merging step. So for every file that we want to process in parallel, we're going to take the balance step. So we want to pipe it through the balance step. The balance would then connect to the import single file flow, and then to the merge. And we need to do it like for every for each. We want to make a similar number of connections that we have the concurrent files here. And those fancy arrows here come from the DSL that we imported previously. And the last thing, well, that we need to return from the create method is something called a shape. So basically, every graph in Akka Streams has something called a shape, and it basically says how many inputs and how many outputs it has. For example, a source shape has no inputs and a single output. A sync shape has a single input and no outputs. And the flow shape that we are using here has a single input and a single output. So we have a flow shape, and the input of the flow, so everything that arrives into our graph is going to be like redirected to the input of the balance state. And what we'll be outputting from our graph would come from the output of the merge step. So we have merge out here. So now we defined our load balancer using a fixed pool of workers using the DSL. The last thing we want to do here is to convert it into a flow. Fortunately, we have a helper method for this, which basically takes a graph and converts it into a flow. Okay, so we are almost ready to run it. One more thing we want to do here is like have our actual application. That basically does some initial setup, and we want to have a CSV importer import from files. And let's now see whether we are actually ready to run it. So we're going to launch SBT here and compile. And it turns out we are not ready to run it yet. There's a couple of problems here. First of all is that it's complaining about a missing execution context. So since we are dealing with futures here, and we didn't provide a thread pool or basically a thread pool that will be used for the future processing, and in Scala we need to be explicit about this, so we need to provide a thread pool for the futures. This is the execution context. So that's one thing that is missing here. The second thing that is missing is the materializer. So actually, we have created a recipe for data processing, but we didn't tell Akka Streams how to actually materialize the graph, so how to run it underneath. So let's fix those problems now. So first of all, since we'll be using the default implementation, so the materializer based on actors, so we're going to use an implicit actor system here that will basically be used for running the graph. Well, to have an execution context for our futures, we're going to use the materializer, the dispatcher. So this is the execution context that comes from the actor system. And this is like a shortcut here, because normally we may not want to do it, especially we may not want to do the dispatcher from the actor system to do database operations, because if something goes wrong, if something blocks somewhere, we can just break the actor system itself. But here, so we should always think carefully what execution context do we want to use for different operations. But here, for simplicity, we'll be using the execution context from the actor system everywhere. And so this is the execution context for the futures. The second thing that was missing was a materializer. And we're going to create the default materializer based on the actor system. It's an implicit val, and you can see that it's using the implicit parameter. This is the actor system that we defined here. So to use the actor materializer, we need to have an implicit actor system in scope. That's why we defined it here. So let's get back to our compiler. Now it's much better. I have a Cassandra running here in a Docker container. We have an empty table, which will be used for storing our readings. So now let's try to run the code and see what happens. So we can see like a bunch of log lines. You may notice or may not, there are some invalid lines in the files. And now it says that the import is finished. Let's say if there is anything in our Cassandra table. Well, there is, so it looks like it succeeded. Of course, you may use the the different parameters like the parallelism levels, the concurrent files to try to tweak and the application, see how it behaves with different parallelism, different number of concurrent files to process. But basically, there are some default values that are in the default configuration, and they seem to do the job. Okay, actually, I don't have any more time, so... Well, there's only one more thing I want to show here, and it's... Well, but now we have the happy path, so basically if we assume that everything goes fine within the stream, but it may happen that one of the stream stages fails for a reason. And for example, an exception is thrown. And actually, the default behavior in Akka Streams when a processing stage fails is to like cancel all the stream, the entire stream, so it won't resume the processing. There are cases in which we want to like we accept that something may fail, and although something has failed, we want to continue with processing the stream, and there is a way to do it. We can set some attributes on the stream, and for example to be able to control how the stream behaves when an error occurs inside, we have something that is called a supervision strategy. And in a supervision strategy, we're providing something called a decider, and the decider is basically a function that takes a throwable, so an exception that has occurred, and returns a decision, so what we want to do, whether we want to stop, continue, or restart the stream, because that's the options we have. So basically, we have a supervision object, and here are different strategies. Those are the three here. So we can either restart the stream or resume it or stop it. And the default behavior is stop. So for example, if you wanted to restart to continue processing, even when something wrong has happened, we can say we can return supervision resume here, and this would like make the material this would cause the exceptions to be ignored, and we resume the processing, so we'll continue although something bad has happened. Okay, so well, that's the code I had. There is something more. Well, I already showed the DSL for building the non-trivial graphs. This was the part where we implemented the load balancer. You can also build your own stages because, well, there are a lot of stages predefined in Akka Streams that, for example, those fluff map concat, those map async unordered. So this is the built-in stuff, but of course, there is a, this is just an API, so you can implement anything you wish. If you want to see how you can implement one, you can see my blog post. There will be a link at the very end. And actually, the stage I built, I contributed it to the Akka Streams, so it's already there, I think. And that's it. Thank you for your attention. If you scan the QR code, there is a, like, basically a landing page with links to GitHub, to another resources that you may find useful. Here is my Twitter as well. Thank you for your attention.
I have a question for you. You said that there are a lot of tools for stream. Mm-hmm. Can, in your opinion, are there any use cases that are really best to use with Akka Streams, that Akka Streams is better in such use cases from all the rest, or simple just Akka Streams is another tool which is convenient and it might be convenient for me and not convenient for something else?
Well, the answer is it depends, as usual. Well, Akka Streams is, as I said, it's not non-distributed, so it may be faster, for example, to use for some cases to use Akka Streams instead of Apache Spark, for example, which is distributed. It's like more complicated to set it up. And actually, the case that I presented here is based on a real life example, so it's like an anonymized production code from one of our applications, in which we actually needed to import a lot of data into Cassandra. And this seemed to be the best way to do it. Well, we didn't want to like set up Spark just to do it was a one-time thing. So we wanted to do it fast because there was really a lot of data, but we didn't want to like, we didn't need Spark. And actually Akka Streams performed really well. Actually it took us like the export process from the database, which we had data from, took, I think, 2 or 3 days. It was some kind of an Oracle export, and our import on a single node took 11 hours or something. So we were actually able to import the data with some grouping, so with some aggregations inside, faster than it was exported from the database. So I think it was really nice. And you, of course, the Akka Streams is not the only Reactive Streams implementation. For example, in Scala, you have Monix as well. You may have heard of Monix in terms of its tasks, which are basically better Scala features. But Monix also has an implementation of Reactive Streams. Its DSL is like a bit different from the one in Akka Streams. In Akka Streams, it's more like you specify the actual building blocks, so it's less imperative. The DSL in Monix is less declarative, so you say what you want to do and not how you want to do it. And Monix is also not distributed, and actually it's not based on an actor system. So some people say that it's more light, even more lightweight than Akka Streams, because you are not creating an actor system just to do the processing. They have some other implementations.
Okay, so it seems that it's a good point to start with Streams, because it's simpler to deploy than such other powerful parallel tools.
Yeah. Because this is just a Scala application. You don't need to like, you don't have to set up a cluster in Spark or SAS, anything else. You just write an application, use the library, and you're there.